All right. Welcome back to today's Sports Chat.
503.
All right, people, welcome back. If you guys have been joining us for a long time, thank you very much. If it's your first time, then welcome. We do this every week. We talk Ducks. We talk Pac-12. We talk NBA, NFL, college football, Major League Baseball, everything. We don't really talk hockey, but basically we talk everything having to do with sports, so we're Sports Chat. And we do this every week. We are going to be breaking down a lot to talk about this week, Bo.
Yeah.
We've got major bowl news. We're going to the Alamo Bowl. We're playing Texas. We're going to break that down. We've got the rest of the bowls. We're going to break those down. We've got this snowball incident that happened over the weekend.
Yep.
We've got Pac-12 coaching news. We've got NFL playoffs. Looks like they're starting to come into form a little bit. We've got a lot of crazy stuff. And we got Duck basketball playing really well. I'll be going to their next game. That'll be in Portland. Got to represent that one.
Nice.
And then we've got a slew of other things we can go through. NBA and the like. Kobe returns.
Yep.
And because of the Texas battle, I will be drinking out of my only bit of Western decorum that I have, country Western, which is a little glass boot that I'll be drinking out of today.
I dig it.
Agua, people. Okay, Bo, what are your... Whoa, hey, sniper. Bo, what are your thoughts on the Alamo Bowl matchup with Texas?
I think it's going to be a good game. A lot of people are predicting blowouts. Oregon has been inconsistent the last 4 or 5 weeks, and so I've kind of made a choice where I got to recognize this is college football. You can have an off day, you can have an off week, you can have turnovers and injuries. No game is for certain, no game is a guaranteed lock. Texas has a good running back in Malcolm Brown. Their starting running back, Gray, was lost a couple of weeks ago, so he's actually out for the rest of the year, torn Achilles. Malcolm Brown is a bruiser. He can put up yards. They've got some good receivers in Davis and Shipley. Davis is the stud of the group, I think. You got McCoy at quarterback, who doesn't throw a whole lot. The stats against Baylor were kind of wonky because of the weather, so you can't really go on stats from that game. But
you think Texas is a good team?
I think Texas is a good team.
We started the year talking about Texas a lot, thinking that this was the year they were going to rebound. This was going to be the year that Mac Brown was going to save the gig and do the whole thing. And
And
actually, I went back and looked at their schedule. They lost two games early they shouldn't have.
Yeah.
But other than that, they were 10-2 just like us.
Yeah. They lost to Baylor and Oklahoma State, which are acceptable.
But the games early on, they lost to, what was it, BYU was the bad one. That was the second week.
Yep, and then the Ole Miss.
Ole Miss.
Yeah.
And the Ole Miss one, I guess you can kind of understand early in the year. I don't know if it was at Ole Miss, but you can understand a little bit maybe of that. But the week after the BYU loss, which was really uncharacteristic, they couldn't run the ball. Couldn't stop the run. They were just all over the place.
Yeah.
And
they replaced their D coordinator like 4 or 5 weeks into the season, too. So they made some changes.
You know, Texas is Texas, man.
Yeah.
I mean, you want to see the Yankees in the playoffs, even on a down year?
Yeah, definitely.
You know, so I like the matchup. Of course, everybody wants BCS. Who doesn't?
Yeah.
But, you know, you didn't earn it, bud. You know, you came out, and if you're this Ducks team, you got to think, hey, I got to take what I was given.
Yeah.
I had everything laid out in front of me, the whole thing. It would have been Florida State, Oregon, and the SEC would have been pissed. They maybe would have tried to make some sort of case that it would have been LSU or Auburn over Oregon. And I would have even probably accepted that a little bit, but if we would have been undefeated, there's nobody anybody could have said anything. The one loss team's going to be out.
Yep. And I totally agree.
You know, everything was laid out. Didn't happen. Okay? You know, you lose to Stanford. Stanford's a tough team. You know, they're taking it to everybody, and that running game is really hard to stop. They're just pushing people over.
Yep.
And then you lose uncharacteristic game to Arizona, and that was a game you didn't show up. You know, maybe it was an arrogance thing. People have said, the commentators on YouTube and on the – everybody else is all over the place talking about, you know, you didn't want the Rose Bowl. How about this, this, that, and the other?
Yeah.
It really comes down to the fact that Arizona came out, played with their hair on fire. We came out sluggish, weird weather condition game. And, you know, it happened, you know.
Yeah.
And it hasn't happened, and people have been so used to it not happening that it seems really out of the ordinary. And it is. But if you go to any other college in any other part in the country, this does happen.
Yeah.
There are teams that win 8-9 weeks in a row and then lose a bad loss.
Yep.
The fact that Oregon lost two isn't really saying that much, because you probably should have been in the game with Stanford, but you were blown out in the Arizona loss. You know, that is definitely a loss. And if you looked at a one-loss Oregon team against a one-loss Auburn team after winning the Alabama game and everything, you probably would have had Auburn anyway.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So that's why I say this four-game playoff doesn't really solve anything, because now Oregon's going to be on the outside looking in again, because they're going to have a situation where you're going to have two SEC schools in there. Big 12, Big 10 are all going to find their way in that four-game playoff.
Yeah, see?
And you're going to have Oregon on the fifth. So it is an end of an era a little bit, it feels like. But, hey, we're still excited. We're going to the Alamo Bowl. We'll be having fun and doing that thing up.
Yeah, it'll be good.
So I actually think it's going to be a closer game, too. I don't think it's going to be quite the blowout. It's down there. You know it's going to be the first quarter is going to be rowdy. People are going to be fired up.
Yeah.
You know, and who knows with this Oregon team? You know, if you would have asked me this 5 weeks ago, you say it's a 50-point, you're going to hang on them. You know, now, I don't know. You know, and I don't know if we can stop what they're doing. I don't know if they can stop what we're doing. I do think Oregon's going to score more, and therefore Oregon's going to win the game. But I wouldn't be surprised if it's a one-touchdown game.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, bowl games do get tight.
Yeah, and this is Mac Brown's, you know, a lot of people saying that he shouldn't come back next year. So he's got a lot on the line for this game, not just personally and professionally. But, I mean, he's got a contract through, like, 2018 or 2020. But they could choose not to bring him back. So he's going to be fired up. His kids are going to be fired up because I'm sure they don't want to see him go.
No.
So there's all of these other factors going into this game. And it's in Texas.
Yeah, it's about 2 miles or 2 hours away. Or,
So, Texas is going to have crazy fan support for this game.
Yeah, it's tucked in. San Antonio's close to Austin. It's going to be a hell of a game. I really think, you know, you got to take a step back a little bit, you know. Maybe this is one of the best things you could have for this BCS run, to take a quick time out, reassess.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll give you three examples, okay? Boston Red Sox last year, okay? Boston Red Sox went from one of the best teams in their league, lost, came back, won a World Series.
Yeah.
Auburn was not crazy. In the top 25 to start the year. Yeah. Now they're in the championship game, and they got every good a chance to win that game as anybody.
Yeah, they do.
Okay?
Yeah.
And the other one is our Oregon team. When you go back and look at this little run we had after Bilotti's big run when we beat Texas and all that sort of stuff in 2000, there was a little run where we were making, and then it went to a dip, and you went to, like, not even having a bowl 1 year. I mean, and you're losing in a Las Vegas bowl kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I do think that some of that stuff might be beneficial. At the same time, Alabama being knocked out of the national championship is going to do the same thing for them.
Yeah.
So we're still not at that elite top of the pyramid level.
Yeah.
We're right in that zone underneath it. We're competing with the big boys, and that's great. But until we can go either undefeated or until we can start beating some of these teams, that stigma and that thing still exists.
Yeah. And if this year proves anything, it's that even if you do get to that level, that elite level, you're still vulnerable. Those teams still lose games.
Well, and everybody's coming after you.
Yeah.
You know, you got a target on your back, and you can't come into anything thinking that you're better than them and thinking everything's good. You're going to get run.
Yeah. So
and the Pac-12 is a hell of a conference.
It is. Yeah, it is. So it's very, being able to get to a national championship or even a BCS bowl game is very difficult. There's a lot of good teams.
Yeah. Now, let's break this thing down a little bit, shall we, this bowl?
Yeah.
Games, all these games. Are you ready
good.
For this?
Yeah.
Okay. So the Ducks, I mean, the Ducks are what they are. We've pretty much covered it. We think it's going to be all right. Can we do let's do Snowball.
Let me do
because we're losing the tight end.
All right, yeah, let's do Snowball, and then I got something to say about Texas.
Snowball. Well, Snowball, we had snow in Eugene, rarely have snow. People are out playing in it. They set up a deal where the students versus the football team in a snowball fight. Things happen, everything's cool, and then all of a sudden people are driving around in the cars. I don't know why people are driving, where they're going, whatnot. But the people start pelting the thing with cars, mob mentality. People start, dude dumps a whole like basket or thing on the thing. Yeah. And that's Farrell Brown, the starting tight end. So now we've got the tight end. He's not even able to play in a game because of snow.
Yeah,
because
he was in a snowball fight.
You know, where there's... Yeah. I'm assuming you're now looking at Oregon being so sensitive to any single thing that's happening.
Yeah.
That you're going to go above and beyond just to try... I mean, they suspended the kids for selling the shoes for 9 games.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know.
So, yeah, I think it's a little overboard, a little ridiculous. I know they're trying to hold up the integrity or whatnot of the school and the program, but I think it's pretty ridiculous.
I mean, snowballs probably should not warrant a full game suspension of a bowl game.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, come on. Yeah. You know, that's a little much. Of course, I'm thinking this as a fan, but, you know, it is what it is. And I understand, hey, you shouldn't be stopping people in traffic. You shouldn't be messing around with people's cars. You shouldn't be creating a sense of danger or any sort of thing like that. But at the same time, you know, keep it in check a little bit. You know, the punishment should fit the crime.
Yeah. So I want to say real
Texas,
quick.
Texas, yeah.
Texas, their defense, they've got some studs on defense. They've got a kid, Jeffco, who leads the team in tackles and sacks. He's got 12 sacks on the season.
Wow.
They got another kid, Reed, who's got 9 sacks on the season. And then they also have some good DBs like Thomas, who's got 3 picks. Phillips, who's got a lot of tackles and 2 picks. Edmonds, who's got 2 picks, or Edmond is his last name. And so they have some defensive playmakers that can get to the quarterback and cause sacks. And so with Oregon and Mariota's mobility, I think he'll be fine for the game. I think he'll be healed. I think he'll be mobile. And so some of those sacks may come as a result of him scrambling and trying to evade and not pick up yardage and getting hit in the backfield. But, you know, defense for Texas, they've got some studs that can play deep.
Oh, yeah.
So, and with their running game, Eaton Clark and their defensive line there, I think...
No, it's not a gimme at all.
Yeah, exactly. I think Oregon is going to have to be able to produce not just with the run game, but also be effective with the pass game. And
I agree.
And it's been kind of hit and miss with both of those. So I'm interested to see how Oregon plays. We'll have more about the Duck game coming up.
We still got plenty of time to talk about everything. Yeah. But it is an interesting matchup. I do think that Oregon probably, if you compare them to Oklahoma or you compare them to Clemson, might have just as good of a chance as any of those other teams. But at the same time, you know, we didn't have the opportunity to have our league play for the national championship. And, you know, the Big 12 has been left out a couple years by the only one team going to the Big 12 or to the BCS. I knew the Big 12 was going to try to jam their players or their teams in here this year.
Yeah.
You know, and the fact that you have them without a conference champion and some schools that have the conference champion... You have some conferences that play 9 games, you have other ones that play 8 games. You know, I think going forward, all those things should be equal. You know, each conference should have the same amount of things, and everybody should be playing on... You can't get it completely equal. You know, somebody's going to play Troy, and somebody's going to have to go play Virginia.
Yeah.
And obviously, those are going to be different. But at the same time, when you talk about having... at least amount of the games or anything else, everybody should have an equal shot at this thing.
Yeah.
Because you're talking 4-game playoff, there's still going to be plenty of teams on that 5, 6, 7, 8. And when you look at it from the outside and you look at it and say, hey, well, that doesn't really matter. You know, they're 5th place. If they were that good, they should be in the top 4. I agree with that. But when you talk about 5 major conferences and only 4 spots, you're leaving a conference out. You know, if you do all 4 from 4 different.
Right.
If you do the SEC and 2 of them are from there, then you're leaving out more. So I do think that there is going to be real live arguments, possibly not to the level we had in the BCS, but on a level of saying, hey, let's do this. And this year, let's talk about it. Who would it be?
Well, obviously FSU.
And Auburn.
Auburn. And I'd have to think Bama, because if Auburn's good enough to go...
Well, but Auburn won the SEC championship.
That's true.
So let's do this. Because Michigan State would be in.
I wouldn't put Michigan State in there.
I understand, but if you're going conference champion.
Oh, okay. Is that the theory for the playoffs?
I'm just saying, if that was.
Yeah, if that was the theory, yeah.
Because Michigan State goes over Ohio State.
And
you see what I'm saying? I think the criteria for this thing has got to be really laid out plain, because you can't just be like, you know what? I think Ohio State's better than Michigan State when Michigan State just beat them.
Yeah.
That mentality to me drives me nuts.
Yeah.
When you try to say, oh, well, Ohio State was better, they just lost.
Yeah.
Well, then they shouldn't. I mean.
Yeah.
So, because that's going to be the penalty against Oregon. Well, they lost.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
But Michigan didn't. Michigan's great, or whatever it is. You know,
so the theory then could be like Florida State, Michigan State, Auburn.
You know, and Auburn. Baylor? So it would be Auburn and Florida State on two ends. Yeah. They'd be playing somebody else.
Yeah.
So then it would probably be that Florida State would be playing Michigan State.
Yeah.
Or Florida State would be playing Bama. And then you'd have Auburn be playing the third place team, which would be who? Would that be, you know,
Baylor,
Stanford? Baylor, probably. Yeah. It would be Baylor. So this year.
Yeah.
But if you were to give me Baylor versus Stanford, I'd probably like Stanford right now.
Yeah.
If you were to give me Auburn versus Stanford, I would have to say Auburn. But at the same time, Stanford would probably give them a hell of a run.
Yeah.
If I was to say Florida State versus Bama, maybe I like Bama.
Yeah. Yeah. No,
I mean,
kidding.
So it's just that's another weird part is that once you get into this four-game thing,
yeah.
It's depending on who you're going to play in the first game to even give yourself a chance
yeah.
to get to the other one.
Yeah, that's true. Like, if it was who I think the four best teams are,
yeah.
I would probably go this year, Florida State, Auburn, Bama.
And Ohio then, State. You'd probably
yeah, and I'd probably, yeah, I'd probably.
Even though they just lost and they have the same record as Michigan State.
Yeah, and even though, yeah, Baylor, you know, has, you know, won the Big 12 and Stanford won the Pac-12. I would probably still put Ohio State in there. Yeah.
So there's the argument. Is
exactly.
That you have these people in the room and everybody's lobbying for their thing. You're gonna get the top two, and then you're gonna get maybe the third, and then that fourth is gonna be a little weird.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Because everybody is gonna try to jam in their interest.
Yeah. Auburn was even trying to make a case for them going to the national title, even if Ohio State won. Yeah.
So. If I were to put that four right now, I would actually put, based on schedule, based on performance, based on wins and losses, as your top two teams, FSU and Auburn. And then I'd probably have to put in Michigan State and Baylor.
No Bama.
Because
they didn't even go to the conference championship.
Right.
So that makes sense that they shouldn't deserve a spot.
But at the same time, if I'm looking at them versus Baylor...
Yeah.
And I'm saying, okay, Baylor didn't have to play in a conference championship either. They've lost one game. Who did they lose to? How did they lose? Versus Bama? Now I take Baylor out and put Bama in.
Yeah.
But if I had to go on who gets in first, who's my first look, it's the conference champions.
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, and even by that theory, you're still, you know, going to have, as of this year, four conference champions and the Big 12 – who doesn't have actually a conference championship game, but they'll still have a conference champion because whoever has the best record wins the conference.
Well, let's look at a couple years ago.
So,
you know, for the last couple 4 years, I would actually say in the last 4 years, the top four teams in the country have been Alabama, Auburn, in the national ranking thing.
Yeah.
And not because Auburn has been down a couple years, but Alabama, Auburn, Oregon, and Stanford.
Yeah.
Okay. They've been to all these BCS bowls in a row, yeah. Whatever, okay? Even though Auburn had taken a couple years off. If you looked at those four schools, okay, and you were to say, would those four even have an opportunity to be in a playoff? So the year that, let's say, Oregon, you know, was a one-loss team or won everything, and the year that Stanford lost the one game to Oregon. Uh-huh. Stanford's got Andrew Luck. They got all these guys, you know.
Yeah.
That's the second best team in the Pac-12. One loss team. The equivalent of a Michigan State, Ohio State, Baylor.
Yeah.
But they didn't go to their championship game because Oregon did.
Mm-hmm.
Or reverse it. Oregon gets beat by Stanford. So Oregon doesn't go to the championship game, but Stanford goes undefeated. Stanford's in that situation.
Yeah.
Would two Pac-12 schools ever go into this four-game playoff?
I don't believe so.
I don't see that either.
No.
But I do see it as maybe if USC was one of those schools, if they were in the hunt, and Oregon was undefeated,
yeah.
Maybe. But I do see a real-life scenario of almost every other year, two SEC schools in there.
Yeah, me too.
Because the year that you had Bama and LSU playing each other and losing and beating each other in the deal,
yep.
They would have both been in that four-game playoff.
Yeah.
Because if you're asking the committee to look back and say, who's the best four teams you've seen this year? Well, for half the year, Oregon's one of those four teams.
Yeah. Yep.
But for the second half of the year, they weren't.
Yeah.
And so what do you do then? You know, you look at, let's say you look at Baylor. Baylor was killing. You know, Baylor goes through the Big 12. The Big 12's a good conference, but Baylor doesn't have a crazy, outrageous schedule.
No.
They have no conference championship.
Right.
So they got to win a couple games to get in. Should they be in the conversation? Because if you're looking and asking this committee to make the decision of who's the best four teams, I don't even know if Baylor's on that list this year, even though they won the Big 12. Two Big 12 teams are going to the BCS this year.
Yeah.
You've got, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
You might still have Bama, Auburn, Florida State, and Michigan State, Ohio State. It would probably be Michigan State because they just won.
Yeah.
But it might just be Stanford.
And yeah.
They would jump because they'd say, oh, Pac-12 is stronger than the Big Ten. Let's take the Pac-12 champion instead.
Yeah. I mean, it's tough because...
With two losses instead of one loss.
Right. And it's tough because here's a scenario. Let's say Florida State had a loss. They wouldn't even be playing for the national title.
Oh, they'd be way on the outside looking at it.
Yeah.
They'd say, oh, ACC isn't that good.
Exactly. So of all the one-loss teams, if Florida State happened to be one of them, they wouldn't even be considered for the national championship. It would probably be Auburn, Alabama.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, there you go. It's,
right.
So basically the way I see it is any conference outside of the SEC, you're going to have to pretty much be undefeated to make it into the playoff.
Yes.
And the SEC, because of their past and the present, actually, kind of get a pass so that you can get to the playoff if you have a loss.
Or if that loss is to another team in that four.
Yeah.
Or top five.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
And see, that's the thing. Like, does the new playoff factor in how well the team has played the last few years? Or is it all based on
this year?
This
and
year
I
only?
Actually think it's more based on what you've done lately than what you've done in the past.
You mean?
So let's take, for example, Auburn. Auburn loses early on in the year to LSU.
Yeah.
The LSU loss is nowhere near the same Auburn team we're seeing right now.
Yeah.
Using another example, Oregon beats the living hell out of Tennessee. Is Oregon the same team right now than they were than when they beat Tennessee?
No.
Probably not. No. So when you look at it like that, you know, maybe you are right to say who's what. Problem is, you put them in a bowl game, you might get the Oregon-Tennessee Oregon back. You might not get what you think out of the other one.
Yeah.
You know, the team that's hot at the end of the year, sometimes that doesn't carry over for the bowl game.
Yeah. Yeah. And, like, you know, the whole reason why Auburn is the one-loss team in the championship is because they just came off beating Bama. If they, you know, Ohio State only has one loss, Baylor only has one loss, so, you know, record-wise, they have as much right to be in there as Auburn.
Yeah.
The problem is that Ohio State lost in the conference championship,
right.
And Baylor lost to Oklahoma State, just got blown out.
Oh, yeah.
And Oklahoma State just lost to Oklahoma, so that loss looks even worse now for Baylor than if Oklahoma State had
won,
and they would have won the Big 12 championship.
Right.
So, yeah, it's never going to be totally fair. It's
no.
It's always going to be second guess.
But it is very entertaining.
Yeah, it's fun. It's like, it's like, I can
and that's
see,
really what it is. It's like a reality show.
Yeah, I can see why people are into fantasy sports and all that stuff, because they get to delve into this and put numerical values on everything.
Yeah, that's the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
okay, let's go through these bowls, shall we?
Yes, I was.
I am ready for this.
Yes.
I got my iPad hooked up. Let's do this thing. Let's start with the New Mexico Bowl. Well, let's do it real quick.
Yeah.
Who do you like, Washington State, Colorado State?
I like Washington State, man. They've been putting it up. They don't run the ball much, but they give a...
I think they throw the ball, like, more than anybody in the country, probably.
Yeah,
except
I think
for the Beavs.
So. Yeah, probably. So, I like Washington State.
Let's do... Yeah, go
and,
ahead.
And out of the 12 Pac-12 schools, 9 of them are going to bowl games.
Yeah.
So, I think that's pretty impressive.
That is.
I like
and
that.
I think they're going to win. I think, actually, they're favored in every game.
Yeah, I think... I was looking through them, and I think there's only one game that I think might be a problem, but we'll get to that.
Let's do this. Fresno State, USC. That's the New Mexico? No, that's the Holiday Bowl.
Yeah, see, that's tough. Fresno
no,
State...
No, that's the Vegas Bowl.
The Vegas, yeah, the Royal Purple. Yeah, SC should win this game, but Fresno State's had a good year, so I can't just automatically give this to SC.
Great game for Fresno State.
Yeah.
Huge game for Fresno State.
Yeah.
Not really a marquee game for USC.
No.
Tends to make me think Fresno State in this one.
Yeah, I can't give it to USC right away.
It's... You know, USC, of course, on paper looks to dominate this game. And, I do like Washington State as well.
Yeah.
I probably like USC to win this game, but Fresno State, don't put it past them. They could come up. They could make this game a good game.
Yeah.
Ohio Potato Bowl. Idaho Potato Bowl. Let's get Buffalo and the Aztecs, San Diego State. Who do you like there?
I don't know either
of these teams.
I don't know either of them either.
I'll take San Diego State.
I'll go Buffalo.
Sweet. Let's do that.
Nice.
Let's do a New Orleans Bowl, and that's Tulane against Louisiana Lafayette. Now, aren't both those schools from that area?
They are. Yeah. So that should be good home crowd.
Good home cooking.
I'll go Tulane.
Nice. I'll go Louisiana Lafayette.
Very nice.
Now, let's go East Carolina, Ohio in the St. Petersburg Beef O'Brady Bowl.
I'll go Ohio.
I like that. I'll go East Carolina.
Good.
Boise State, Oregon State, they get to go to Hawaii.
You know, for the Beavs, this is a pretty sweet bowl game.
Oh, if you were going to tell me that the Beavs could go to Hawaii 2 weeks ago after getting the hell kicked out of them by Washington, you take that.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, when you were wishing.
Against Boise?
Yeah, when you were wishing guys, you know, hey, good luck in your bowl game, they were probably like, yeah, we're going to be stuck in Detroit or something. No, son,
this
you're going
is a
to
good
Hawaii.
One.
Yeah.
This is a good one. And it's also the only bowl on that night. It's Christmas Eve.
Awesome. Yeah.
But, hell, you're going to get people watching that game.
Yeah. Now, here's a question. You have teams like Washington or, Boise State, for example, whose coaches have gone elsewhere.
Yeah.
So,
air it out.
Is Peterson coaching Boise State in this game? He's gone.
Mm-mm.
Like, Sark isn't coaching Washington in their bowl game. He's gone?
No.
Okay, yeah, I'm definitely going Oregon State. I'd probably go Oregon State anyways.
Oh, yeah, I like Oregon State either way.
Yeah.
Yep. They're in their deal. Uh-huh. Let's go with Little Caesars Bowl. That's in Detroit, and that's Pittsburgh Bowling Green.
Bowling Green put a shellacking on
they
Northern Illinois.
Good. Now, Pittsburgh usually is better, but they're 6-6. I like Bowling Green.
I like Bowling Green too, man.
Let's go Utah State, Northern Illinois, speaking of.
Yep.
Poinsettia Bowl.
Yeah, and I think I'm gonna go Northern Illinois. Fresno State beat Utah State last week.
Utah State did not look very good in that game.
Yeah,
I watched some of that.
So they're coming off.
Now, this is a good chance for these people to warm up.
Yeah.
San Diego?
Yeah.
For Northern Illinois and Utah?
Yeah, that's a good spot.
That's a nice little spot for them.
Yeah, short of Hawaii, that's a good place.
And I love the Bulls. This is one of the beautiful things about the Bulls, you know?
Yeah.
Sit back and relax. We don't have a whole thing for college football. This is the thing.
Yeah.
Let's do the Military Bowl, Marshall, Maryland.
I like Maryland.
I like Marshall.
Yeah, I think Maryland's a physical team. They're actually...
Maryland is going into, what, the Big Ten?
Are they really?
I think so.
That would be sweet.
They're leaving the ACC is what I'm thinking.
Damn.
Yes.
That's good, man.
Let's go Texas Bowl, Syracuse, Minnesota.
I like Minnesota this year.
I like Syracuse.
Yeah.
I think they're going to lose, but since you went Minnesota, I'll go Syracuse.
Yeah, good.
I like Carmelo Anthony, you know, that whole era of...
Yeah, I dig. And Donovan McNabb and those kids.
Yeah. BYU, Washington. This is a big one. This is the Kraft Fight Hunger Bowl.
Yeah, I'm going UW. It'll be interesting without Sarkisian there, but I think Washington's good, man.
BYU is a physical team.
Yeah, they beat Texas.
They did, and they ran for more yardage than anyone in the history of Texas.
Is that right?
I think they did. I think they ran. Yeah, they're for 1,000 yards rushing. I don't know what it was.
Holy shit.
Let's do the Bronx. This is a good one. Notre Dame and Rutgers.
Yeah, it should be a good game. I don't like Notre Dame, so I'm not going to pick them. I'm going Rutgers.
You know what? Rutgers is basically playing a home game here. They're from New Jersey.
That's
so Notre Dame playing in Yankee Stadium is pretty cool, though.
Yeah, I like that.
Brings
cool.
back the kind of history of Newt Rockne in the old days.
Yep.
I'll go Notre Dame. I like the Domers.
Good.
Let's do the Belk Bowl. Everybody knows the Belk Bowl.
Surely.
That's North Carolina and Cincinnati.
I've been dreaming about that one since I was a youngin'.
You know, North Carolina's 6-6, but I think they bring it in this one.
Yeah, I'm going Cincy. North Carolina got knocked off by Duke a couple times.
Yeah.
I
Duke's
like Cincinnati.
Pretty good this year, though.
They are.
Now, how about Louisville, Miami? This is a big game.
Yeah, this is a fun game that I think is going to be good.
Orlando, this is the Russell Athletic Bowl.
Yeah, I'm taking Miami, man.
Gotta like the Canes in this one, huh?
I do.
Louisville, I'm actually going Louisville in this one. Canes look like a disaster. I think they're going down to Florida, and Teddy Bridgewater's going to run all over everybody, just like he did last year against Florida. Michigan, Kansas State in the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl.
Yeah, I like Michigan, man. Gardner had a hell of a game against Ohio State. I want
Kansas to see State does not look that impressive this year.
No, they sure do not.
Yeah, I'd like not. To see Michigan wrap up the year with a victory.
Yeah.
Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl. Now, is Bell Helicopter really trying to promote sales to people? Are people buying helicopters?
You know, it's funny.
Is that
maybe
a big market?
I don't know. Maybe they're just promoting it for military spending.
Right? I mean, I guess.
You got to advertise.
There's going to be somebody out there buying a helicopter being like, I think I'll go Bell.
Yeah, maybe not even U.S. military.
Like they show the guy like getting up for work in the morning and then going out to his helicopter.
That's why I fly a Bell.
Exactly. But the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl sees Middle Tennessee versus Navy.
Hey, it's an Armed Forces Bowl.
I'm going Navy.
I'm going with the Armed
Midshipmen.
Forces.
Midshipmen.
Yep.
Ole Miss, Georgia Tech in the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl.
It's a long, long one.
Music City Bowl. Everybody knows that. Nashville, baby.
Yeah, I like Georgia Tech's offense. They run this crazy, like, flex bone. Yeah, it's crazy, dude. It's
I like the name of that.
Yeah, it's a crazy offense. I like it. It's, they play well. I like
I'm going to go running Rebs on this one. I like Ole Miss. Good. And I definitely liked the Ole Miss game the other day the Ducks played. It was an absolute thriller.
Is that right?
Oh, my God. One for the ages. Now we finally get to the Ducks because the Ducks are playing on the December 30th, and we've got the Alamo Bowl, Bo. Oregon, Texas.
Yeah, I'm going Oregon. I'm going to have to give a score for this one, too. I'm going Oregon 32-27.
I was thinking 32-24.
Good.
All right, we're in the same wheelhouse.
Yeah.
Which hopefully means Oregon's going to win.
Yeah.
And hopefully maybe it's about 52-8.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And the National University Holiday Bowl is Arizona State, Texas Tech.
This is a good game. Texas Tech has had a little bit of a hard time. Like, I know Texas held Texas Tech to only 16 points when they played this year. I like Arizona State. The problem is they're starting running back Grice, who was out for the Pac-12 championship.
That's a big one.
Yeah, and then Foster got dinged up, their backup running back. I'm still going Arizona State, though.
Will Sutton.
Yeah, Clingsbury there down at Texas Tech. He does a good job, but...
I got to like the Pac-10 in this one, too.
Yeah.
Arizona Boston College in the Avocare V100 Bowl.
Just self-explanatory.
It is.
I like Arizona, man, and especially if that team that plays Oregon shows up.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah.
Now, this is in Shreveport, Louisiana, and the last time the Ducks went to Shreveport, Louisiana, which was 1989, I do believe, or 1991. I think we went 2 years down there.
Yep.
That one is a cold SOB down there.
Really?
Yeah, it is not warm.
And do you remember a year or two ago, there was some team from down there, from Louisiana, who got the offer to go to a bowl, and they said... We're going to hold off and wait and see if we get a better offer.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, they picked somebody else.
Right.
And that team never got another offer, so they didn't even go to a bowl game.
Yeah.
That was classic, man.
You know, Shreveport is a tough one. I think Arizona wins this one. I like the Pac-12.
Yeah.
Let's do Virginia Tech, UCLA in the Sun Bowl.
Good one again, man. That'll be a good game. I'm taking UCLA.
Gotta like the Pac-12 here as well.
Yep.
And Hundley might be done. He might be going to the NFL.
Is that right?
That's the word on the street. Let's do Rice, Mississippi State in the Liberty Bowl.
I take Mississippi State.
Yeah,
I think they're good.
You know, Mississippi State's probably the way I got to go. 6-6 coming out of the SEC versus 10-3 in Conference USA.
Yeah.
But you know what? Rice might just do some things. Those Owls are tricky.
They got a chance, man.
Let's go Duke A&M.
This is going to be good. Duke shut out Florida State.
If Duke beats A&M, that'd be huge.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think Duke could do it.
Duke's got pretty good defense.
They looked good for about the first 5 minutes in that ACC championship game.
Yeah, and A&M didn't look real good. Who were they playing?
The last couple games were a slide for A&M.
Yeah, they were. So, yeah.
You know what?
I'm going to go Dukies.
You got to still like A&M here, though.
Yeah,
you know, they're still
going
to bring it. But you know what? You never know. Atlanta, Georgia. Who knows?
Yeah.
You know, Duke's been to many Final Fours in Atlanta.
That's right.
How about Nebraska, Georgia? This is a hell of a game. Georgia's got to rebuild.
Yeah, because Murray's gone. He tore
up
his
knee. This is a big game
so
for Georgia. This is like a new era starting for the Bulldogs.
And, you know, with the quarterback gone, I'm taking Nebraska.
You know what? This is Taylor Martinez's 14th year in the program. He should finally get a bowl victory because I think he has been blown in many of these Outback Bowls.
Yeah.
This is the Gator Bowl. So I do like Georgia.
Okay.
In this game. Now, Heart of Dallas Bowl, we got North Texas, and we got your UNLV.
That's right. I take UNLV.
Yeah.
North Texas, I don't think they're going to be able to put together enough to hold off UNLV.
Yeah, you know what? I probably have to go with UNLV as well in this one.
Yeah.
Outback Bowl, we got Iowa. We got LSU.
LSU is going to absolutely stomp the living hell out of Iowa.
I would assume this game is literally going to be called at halftime. Yeah. And they're going to be ambulances on the Iowa sideline. The Hawkeye are not going to end well on this
one. No, they got a rough draw on this
one. Yeah. Capital One Bowl, that's Wisconsin and South Carolina. That's Gamecocks country there. I don't think Wisconsin has a chance in hell against the Gamecocks. What do you think, Bo? Dude, Clowney, you know.
I hear you.
Spurrier.
Shaw, they got Shaw quarterback.
And, dude, if anybody knows the Capital One Bowl, it's in Orlando, it's South Carolina. It feels like they're there every year.
I'm going to go with the upset. I'm going to take Wisconsin. I want them to
Wisconsin,
come out.
The last game I saw them playing Penn State did not look pretty.
I'm picking a lot of Big Ten winners here. I'm picking Nebraska, Big Ten. Michigan, and Wisconsin.
Big Ten.
And, yeah.
We got to go now with the BCS games. We got Pasadena first. Who do we like in this one? Stanford, MSU.
I think Stanford's going to run away with
it. Oh, I do too. I just think it's going to be a freaking Tyler Gaffney show. Yeah. And he'll just
I think it's one of those years where Michigan State is so stoked.
Even though Michigan State is good at defense.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, but they're so stoked. They're going to be there and overwhelmed. Yeah.
They already had their bowl game when they beat Ohio State.
Yeah, Stanford was there last year.
Yeah.
It's going to get ugly, I think. Stanford is probably the most physical team in the country. Yeah. And I think Stanford and Alabama would be the game of the ages right now.
That would be,
I truly see them as almost mirror images of each other.
Yeah.
But Stanford is literally dominating people.
Yep.
UCF Baylor.
UCF got a tough draw here, man. Baylor's going to blow them out. Like I said, you can't judge Baylor on the last game because of the weather. Baylor's going to run all over UCF.
Yes. Oklahoma, where probably the Ducks should have been. You know what?
Yeah.
We would have been really happy to be playing Alabama.
The Ducks were picked over. Like there were other teams picked over Oregon. There were several of them where Oregon could have gone to
Oregon,
that bowl.
Bama makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And Oregon, Oklahoma, I understand it, but it's just kind of ho-hum a little bit at this point.
Yeah.
Great, it's two-storied programs. Great, great, great. But for the right now, the now and moment, I think a lot of people, I think SEC folks wanted to see Oregon, Bama. They wanted to see Oregon get the hell kicked out of them by Bama. Don't get it twisted.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But they wanted to see that matchup once and for all. Shut these Ducks up.
Yeah.
Let this SEC run all over people. And I think Oregon could have gave them a pretty good game. Yeah. I don't know if they would have beat them.
I'd rather have a shot and fail than not get a shot
at the same time. I am pretty excited. I've never really been to Texas to go to the Alamo Bowl to play Texas in Texas.
You're going to go to the basement of the Alamo.
But to go play Texas in Texas, I think is going to be kind of cool. Yeah. And possibly a really good run for our recruiting.
Oh, you bet.
We're really trying to get in there with recruiting, so... You know, that could be a good thing.
Yeah, so Bama over Oklahoma for sure.
Big time, I like that. Oklahoma State, Missouri, Cotton Bowl.
You know, I thought Missouri was going to beat Auburn. Missouri's got a heck of a defense.
I like Missouri.
You know, in this game, a week ago I would have said Missouri. After watching how they got just destroyed by Auburn. Now I'm taking Oklahoma State.
I'm Cowboys, going. I don't know. I like Missouri.
And they're coming off a loss to Oklahoma, but
yeah.
I say, you know, Gundy's going to get them charged up.
How about Clemson Buckeyes?
Ohio State.
Yeah, you got to like Ohio State in this one.
Yeah.
Even though I do see them possibly going down there and being ho-hum, I don't think that's what goes down. I think they come in and they win that one.
Yeah, I agree.
How about Vandy Houston?
That is
the Compass Bowl.
Yeah, I'll take Vanderbilt. They had a decent season.
Yeah, like
SEC
Vandy too.
Getting 8 wins. That's a good job.
Yep. Arkansas State, Ball State. In the Who Gives a Shit Bowl. I like Arkansas State.
I'll take Ball State.
Awesome.
Sure.
And in the game winner of them all, who do we like in this one? Florida State and them War Eagle. Tigers. Auburn. I like Tigers.
Last week I said Ohio State would beat Florida State in the national title. Florida State, Auburn. I'm taking Florida State.
I like Auburn. I say War Eagle.
Yeah.
They are running Chip Kelly's offense with SEC players.
That I would think you would want them to lose just because
it's
we lost to them.
It's not that I don't want them to lose or have any of that sort of thing. I don't
care
at this point.
Hearing you say War Eagle, you know there's so many people watching this right now that are absolutely disgusted by you.
It's not...
Absolutely disgusting. I'm not, they're turning. They're throwing away their computers.
I have nothing to gain by Poor it. Nothing Eagles. To lose.
Wow.
Here's the theory. I'm talking about this year. I'm not talking about the Cam Newton year. Hell no. I'm talking about this year.
Yeah, I know. I'm just kidding.
Gus Malzahn. This is cool. Gus Malzahn's running Chip Kelly's offense basically with SEC players. When I say Chip Kelly's offense, I mean he's talking about running three plays basically.
Oh yeah.
He's running. Over and over and over, he's running tempo, he's running this, he's running that. That's pretty sweet.
I heard that a lot of the play calls that they run there at Auburn are not a true read, that they're designed either for him to hand the ball off or for the quarterback to keep it. He's not really making a read. Yeah,
no.
It's predetermined in the huddle.
It's like pockets in the pants that aren't really pockets. They just look like them.
Yeah, so... I don't know, and I understand that idea because it cuts down on fumbles and turnovers. I think Auburn has had a hell of a run, beaten Bama, beaten Missouri the way they did. They still gave up 42 points to Missouri, who doesn't have that great of an offense. How many points are they going to give up to one of the best offenses in the country?
I agree, and I think Florida State's got one of the best defense in the country, if not the best defense in the country.
Man.
So I don't put it any. I think it's gonna be a hell of a game.
Yeah.
I think I have always liked Florida State. I liked Bobby Bowden back in the old days. I liked Charlie Ward. I've always liked Florida State. But I do like the fact that Auburn was able to resurrect itself. And if the
it's
thing
respectable.
About the,
I respect
yeah,
them.
Yeah, but
think
about the fact that Alabama has basically owned college football for, what, 5-6 years now?
Yeah.
You got Bama. You got Auburn. You got Bama twice. Now you got Auburn again?
Yeah, it's nice, man.
I mean, you got to give respect to that, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
And I saw it firsthand, man. That's a hell of a fan base, and they do their thing, and they get the pom-poms out, and they do it old school, man.
Yeah.
Boom. We're done with college football, Bo, for a little while. Yeah. Let's be done with this.
We'll give you guys some recap, like some previews of bowl games coming up probably.
Oh, yeah. We'll recap it. We'll get at least one more in before
we'll
done.
Talk more about the Texas-Oregon matchup and probably about the national title and stuff.
Yeah. We'll do it all.
Yeah.
Let's talk about NFL, shall
we? Hold on. Can we do coaches real quick?
Oh, yeah. Peterson. So, Coach P goes to Washington.
To Washington. See, now, this is what's funny. Sarkisian has been at Washington for four or five years. How long has it been?
Three, maybe.
If Washington had wanted to hire Peterson then, there's no way Peterson would have gone to Washington. He was being sought after by a lot of top programs for a long time.
Yeah, but he's a choosy kind of guy. I think he wanted to stay close to home. And you know what? I actually think that because when Mike Leach went to Wazoo, I think at that point, that made Washington say, we got to do more for our coach. We got to spend more. We got to get up on this.
Yeah.
They built the new facilities. I think the Leach to Wazoo put a lot of pressure on
Washington.
The Dogs.
Yeah.
Yes. And I think Coach Peterson is a major upgrade from Coach Sark.
Yeah, because what I'm saying is that 3 or 4 years ago, when Washington was looking for a coach, if they had gone to Peterson and said, hey, we would like you to be our coach, he probably would have passed.
They were over.
And the thing is that now Boise has had a couple down years now that they have had most of their studs go off to the NFL.
Oh, yeah.
And so now Washington gets to get a coach that 3 or 4 years ago would have passed. So they actually end up getting a better coach today than they could have gotten 3 or 4 years ago. So I think it's a win-win for Washington.
It is a win-win. And
I think it's
a win-win for USC as well. USC gets Sark, which was an upgrade.
It's an upgrade. I don't think...
From Kiffin.
From Kiffin, yeah. I don't think Sark's the man to be heading the...
I understand that, but
the future of USC.
If I were to tell you as a Trojan fan last year you could have Steve Sarkisian or Lane Kiffin, you'd probably want Sarkisian.
Yeah, I'd take Sarkisian. I'd take David Shaw. I'd take Jim Mora.
But on just that level, USC upgraded.
I'd take Rich Rod.
With Sarkisian.
Yeah.
And UW... upgraded with Peterson. And you know what? Boise State had a run, but that run's over.
Yeah, but he's going to be bringing some innovative offense
to Washington. But you know the thing about Coach Peterson is that he's a little bit of a Mike Riley.
Really?
Meaning that Mike Riley is doing some innovative stuff, fly sweep, that sort of stuff, but keeping it pretty traditional.
Yeah.
So was Peterson. Peterson wasn't doing up-tempo. He wasn't doing zone read. He wasn't doing options.
Yeah.
He was doing straight ahead, pro style, but mixing it up with a little more shotgun, a little bit more ingenuity.
Yeah, doing the
more
the
riverboat gambler thing. But you can't look at just that one game that they played against Oklahoma as the example, the blueprint of what Boise State did.
Yeah.
Boise State had a very, very good defensive line. Every year they were really good up front defensively.
Yeah.
And then they always had good running backs.
Yeah.
So they had a lot of play action stuff. Their quarterbacks were never dominant. Their
quarterback, I think that
Kellen Moore could put it on the money, but their quarterbacks were never dominating big time quarterbacks. It was always predicated off of a little play action, a little bit of the running game, a little bit of your receivers on the outside throwing those balls over, bubble screens and stuff. But they didn't have the kind of ingenuity or outside-the-box thinking or any of that kind of stuff that other teams out here have.
Really?
Rich Rod is more innovative. Chip and Helfrich are more innovative. You're talking about there's guys doing other stuff that is more. The thing about what Peterson did is Peterson gave the little guy a chance. And whenever anybody thinks of the little guy having a chance, they always think they have to do it with smoke and mirrors.
Yeah.
They didn't. They did it with really good athletes that were really good up front. Here's the problem, buddy. They did it in a super weak conference where only had to win one game a year.
Yeah.
That was the tough one.
Yeah.
So what they were able to do, they would pile up yardage against these schools.
Oh, yeah.
But that one time they played Oklahoma,
it was smoke and mirrors.
It wasn't all smoke and mirrors. To be in the window to be playing with Oklahoma when Oklahoma was Oklahoma at that point, you got to be good enough to even just handle the play-by-play to even put yourself in the chance to even win the thing after four quarters.
Yeah.
After four quarters of football, the better team's going to win. And Boise State was able to hang with them close enough to be able to do some weird stuff at the end of the game to win it miraculously.
Yeah.
But when you talk about they weren't miraculously putting that whole thing together the whole game. And they didn't do that against everybody. When Boise State beat Oregon those 2 years, they beat us because they physically manhandled the line of scrimmage.
Yeah.
They had good offensive linemen, but they had really good defensive linemen and fast linebackers.
Yeah.
And they manhandled the line of scrimmage. And then they ran the ball, and they kept the other team off the field. They did stuff kind of like Stanford, but not like on the big jumbo package stuff, just stuff like, I'm telling you, Peterson's much more old school than new innovative.
See, because I would think that Washington wouldn't be interested in pulling in an old school coach because
they're interested in the actual leader of the program. They don't care what offense he runs.
Because, like, Sarkisian, he came in and basically implemented Oregon's offense.
After 2 or 3 years of his offense failing.
Right. So why would they go back to a guy who's running an old style offense?
They're not getting the offense. They're not getting the offense.
So why would they want him then?
Because he's the program guy. See, you don't give a shit. If you're Washington, you don't even care what offense they run. You're getting Peterson, who for 2 years, give a 4 or 5 year period, he was one of the top 4 or 5 coaches in the country.
Right, because of his offense.
Not
like his defense was good, and that's why they were successful. But that's where his value is in his offense.
I think that's also talk about saying Chip Kelly is only offense.
Well, he's not a defensive mind, Chip Kelly. Alioti's a defensive mind.
I understand that.
So you're not going to get Chip Kelly or even Peterson because of their defensive knowledge or.
But you have to understand is that it's not about the offense. It's about the person. So when they hire Peterson, they're hiring a Mike Riley type.
Yeah.
They're hiring a guy who's the good old boy, the grandfather type. They know this guy's not going to drive their car into the ditch. This is an absolute safe play.
So this
and
is
it's
more
an
like,
upgrade. This is like Michigan getting Brady Hoke.
Yeah, I thought that was more desperation, like stop the bleeding than.
No, Michigan is like, forget it. We tried to do some stupid
Rich
fangled.
Rod.
We're going back to traditional. What we know. What are we?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you the other thing about the Huskies. The Husky program is nowhere near where it should be.
Yeah.
You're also bringing in Peterson's expectation that you are to be playing at this level.
Yeah.
One of the things that he brought to Boise State was not a "we're the underdog." He was a "you are part of the elite."
Yeah.
He brought that mentality to a little tiny school in middle Boise.
Right.
That's the thing they want. They want the it factor. They don't care about what offense. When they're gonna run the it factor. Now the offense is kind of like Mike Riley plus Todd Graham plus Mike Leach.
Yeah.
It's not the, like, again, you're talking about some of the craziest wild out offensive minds out in the Pac-12 right now.
Yeah.
Mike Leach is throwing the ball at insane levels.
Yeah.
Rich Rod was running the ball at insane levels. They both have two of the top things in the, whatever the rankings are. Oregon's doing what they're doing with their speed and their tempo and everything.
Yep.
Stanford's doing what they're doing with their old school plow it out style.
That's right.
Okay. You've got Todd Graham doing what he did, and he's bringing just Midwest football. If you watch Arizona State and you watch Michigan State, they look very similar.
Yeah.
Their offenses look very similar. They're not running smoke and mirrors type of stuff. They're running straight ahead stuff.
Yeah.
That is very, very effective.
Yeah, because I guess my point is that if Sarkisian hadn't gone to USC, they'd still be running Oregon's up-tempo
but
style
offense. That was desperation. See, Sarkisian moving to Oregon's style of thing, that's desperation. And that, to me, shows Sarkisian's not that good of a coach.
Right, so, which goes to my point that I don't know why USC is hiring
him. I agree with that.
It's like, wow.
But on the level of Peterson to UW, UW doesn't even want to run Oregon's offense. They don't even care. They want to beat Oregon.
Yeah.
They don't care how you do it. They just want to beat Oregon.
Sure.
They want to beat Washington State. They want to know when they go down to play California teams that they're going to be able to compete or come away with a victory. And I think the Sarkisian era of the Huskies gave a lot of, like, kind of publicity back. They gave kind of this new feeling of momentum. They redid the stadium, and he was kind of a handshaker, and he was a real politician type.
0-4 to 8-4 or whatever.
Yeah, and Sarkisian was a real politician. Now they're getting an actual football coach in there.
Yeah.
Now they're getting a guy who's going to be a Mike Riley. Mike Riley,
leadership style, you mean.
Exactly. And I'm telling you, Mike Riley isn't stupid when it comes to college football. The guy knows what he's doing.
Yeah, I guess I'm confusing Mike Riley, the, like, leadership mentality versus Mike Riley, the play calling.
Yeah.
Like, that's not the same, right?
No, I think
Riley and Peterson.
I think there's a lot of similarities between Riley and Peterson in play calling as well.
Okay.
I mean, when you talk about Riley, you talk about a guy who's willing to...
Because I thought Peterson was like a big rushing guy.
Peterson is a big rushing guy, and used to be that Riley was a rushing guy, too, when he had running backs.
Right.
I mean, you go back to those years where he went, you know, this guy, that guy, the other guy. They had just an absolute stable of running backs. You couldn't stop them.
Yeah.
That little guy, that Simonton, ran for more yardage than anybody in the history of the Pac-12. He broke, like,
damn.
Oh, dude, those guys ran the ball. Those guys were serious. But you start talking about Coach Peterson. Peterson is really a guy who's kind of a... I would say more of a nickel and dimer than a smoke and mirrors guy.
Yeah.
He's an up and under guy. He's a fly sweep guy. He's
that's
6 yards.
Good
description. And that's a lot what Riley does. Yeah. Riley is West Coast. It's old school West Coast football.
Yeah.
It's take the underneath stuff, and then every once in a while I'll gash you over the top. I'll run the ball, then I'll set up the play action. I'll throw the ball over you.
Yeah.
It's not that different than what they do the rest of the places. They just do it with a different style of athlete. And Washington has historically had top-flight athletes. They are able to have top-flight defensive linemen and top-flight offensive linemen. And if you can do that, you can control the line of scrimmage. You control the line of scrimmage, you can win football games.
Yeah.
I mean, that's as easy as it goes.
Yeah.
Peterson will bring that back. He will bring those lines back. He will bring that ball control, that time possession. He'll bring all that back to Washington.
Yeah.
And Washington, I guarantee you, will look more like Stanford or look more like Oregon State than will look, yes. And when you see the Pac-12 North, you see innovation with Oregon and Mike Leach. And then you see opposite innovation or the other side of the innovation with Stanford. And then you're going to see Cal running what they run, Oregon State running what they run, and Washington running what they run. And those are all kind of in the same little old-timey but new little wrinkles put on it. Yeah. Not crazy innovation.
I see them doing Washington with Peterson doing more of the spread shotgun formation stuff than the under like, the center double
more
tight
like Mike
end
Leach,
kind of thing.
But not with the running game. See, so my whole theory is this, is that when you have the spread them out theory with Mike Leach, you don't have the running game. Because you're losing that backer in the backfield.
Right.
Whereas I think Coach Peterson and Mike Riley both like to operate that with the running back.
Yeah.
So they can still have play action with those receivers spread out.
Yeah.
When those guys spread out and they run play action, that's only a 2 or 3 step drop in the NFL. That's a short passing pattern.
Yeah.
So that's a real quick one over the middle.
Yeah.
That's not the big step back and chuck it over the top.
Right.
Which is, I think, the mentality people have when they think spread out passing attack,
yeah.
that you're going deep. And it's not the case. You're yeah. running guys across the middle and crossing each other over.
Yeah.
And you're basically just trying to set screens
right.
and trying to pick guys
yeah.
to create openings.
Yeah.
I think that what Mike Leach does with that, I think Coach Peterson does a lot of. But it's not everything. Peterson's much more balanced. That's why I say he's like Riley. If Riley could have his druthers, he'd be having absolute balance, run pass.
Yeah.
I just think that he hasn't had the personnel to where he's able to do that. He hasn't even had a running back to where he can run the ball for 3 years now, 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
And so, you know, at the end of the year, he finally tried to give, you know, the ball, the running back. They tried to do some stuff. They got some running yards against Oregon. But I think if you look at Riley, Riley's a guy who is a classic with some wrinkles and then Riverboat Gambler. When you go Riverboat Gambler, add up to that, that makes it look like it's wild and anything goes and all this other sort of stuff. And Peterson's not that way. Peterson knew in that Oklahoma game, his players were not as good as their players. If he didn't take the opportunity to maximize that thing when he had it right then, it was going to overtime, he was losing. Maximize it right now, run the go for two, run the Statue of Liberty, fake the thing out, make the thing happen,
yeah.
ball game.
Right.
But I could see Texas running the same similar thing. You know, just because you're Texas,
yeah.
just because you're Ohio State, just because you're, I could still see schools like that running a similar type of 2-point conversion
yeah.
and then being like, whoa, that was crafty football.
Yeah.
But when the little guy does it from Boise State, it's, oh, the only way you can do it is by tricking everybody else. It's,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
Because I don't see him going into Washington and being able to physically dominate teams like a team like Stanford. Or as he can. So if
no, but,
he's planning
but,
on running an offense that's dependent upon his offensive line
yeah.
dominating the other team,
but
that's
you,
not going to work.
No,
there's very few teams like that. There's probably 3 or 4 in the whole country that can do that.
Well, I'm not saying he's going to be, again.
Washington's not going to be one
it's
of
all
them.
About balance. They're not going to be Stanford.
Yeah.
But they're not going to be Wazoo.
Yeah.
They're going to be Oregon State.
Yeah.
They're gonna be that blend. They're gonna be, you know, they're gonna look much more like Boise State with, you know, the purple and gold.
Yeah.
And when you looked at those Boise State games, the main thing about it was they ran the ball, they had play action, and they had a lot of the underneath stuff. And
yeah.
then every once in a while, one would open up over the top. What do you see on SportsCenter? The one play that goes over the top. The
yeah.
one play that's the crazy play.
Right.
Whereas the standard, the 60 other plays they ran in that game were pretty well straight ahead football.
Yeah.
I think the beauty of Coach Peterson is that idea that he's going to walk in and say, hey, we can compete with anybody. We're going to turn this thing around. This is going to be, he's a real rah-rah guy. That's why I say he's like Riley. He's like, and he's not a menacing guy. He's a lot like Helfrich too in that matter. He's not a in-your-face screamer type.
Yeah.
He's pretty well male-mannered.
Nice.
Yeah. Anyway, let's do this thing, shall
yeah,
we?
Yeah, this will be a good year for Pac-12 just got better, I think.
It's going to take, it. They did.
Yeah.
It's going to still take Peterson 2 or 3 years, though.
Yeah.
Nowhere fast. NFL. Snow.
Yeah, crazy snow, man.
Tons of snow. So, how about, let's go NFC first.
Yeah.
Seahawks lose. That's a big game.
Yeah, that was a tough game, but I think if they played 10 times, Seahawks would win 9 of the 10 times.
Okay. Eagles win.
Yeah,
that's
that was
a big game.
That was a great game, man. They came back, scored 28 in the fourth quarter.
Huge.
Yeah.
Okay. So if we're thinking the NFC right now, and then the Saints win in the Dome, beat Carolina.
Yeah, that was nice.
Those are probably your three biggest games of the NFC.
Yeah,
Bears are playing tonight.
Yeah.
Tonight's Monday Night Football.
That's right.
So, NFC, I mean, are you thinking that the Eagles might have a chance in the playoffs?
I think the Eagles will make the playoffs, yeah.
And might have a look at it? I mean, I don't think anybody's beating Seattle right now.
No, I agree with that. And I think the Eagles will make the playoffs. I don't think they're going to get out of the first round.
If the Eagles had to go play the Saints down in the Dome, they'd lose.
Yeah, right. I agree. Yeah. And it's more to do with their defense than it is their offense. They've got good weapons. I mean, they've been working with Foles. They got LeSean McCoy and DeSean Jackson and Cooper.
How about Eagles Detroit?
They just played yesterday, yeah. And
but,
I think
but in the Dome up in Detroit.
If they played in the Dome up in Detroit,
it's a tough one.
Yeah, I might have to pick Lions. Yeah.
Now you got Bears and you got Cowboys tonight. Cowboys are that other team in the East.
Yeah, the Cowboys would be the one probably to knock out Dallas, but I don't know. I don't like Dallas. I don't think they're gonna end up making the playoffs. Eagles are gonna go ahead of them, so
yeah. What about AFC? AFC Gronk gets hurt; he's out for the year.
He's gone.
A big deal for them.
And so I think that's it.
It's Denver.
Yeah,
it's,
I don't.
Did it look
that's
like
it
it's
for the
else?
Pats. No, and that's the thing is that with the Pats last week, I was saying that if they faced off against Denver, I would pick the Patriots.
Sure,
they're on a roll. Brady's doing great. Without Gronkowski, Pats are done.
It's tough.
They'll make the playoffs, but they're not going anywhere. It's Denver.
AFC North, I mean, Jesus Christ. Does anybody want to win this thing? I mean, Browns, Bengals, you know, Ravens, Steelers.
Yeah,
it's terrible right now. I actually think the team that might be okay on that wild card level if they get in is the Dolphins. I know that they just beat Pittsburgh the other day.
Yeah, that's right. Did you see that? Did you see that return, dude?
Jesus.
Wow.
Right, but you know, if you're thinking about those teams that might be wild card-ish and be able to might make some noise, Dolphins might be able to do something.
Yeah, I don't know. It seems pretty pretty desperate down there. I don't.
Yeah, what about Andrew Luck and the Colts, man? Those guys are hurting too.
That's the other thing, man. The Colts, they can't seem to get it together now that Reggie Wayne's gone. I feel bad for Luck because he had a great season going with them this year. But it's all going to come to
So it looks like it's KC. It looks like it's Denver. Denver's already swept them. We know that situation. Denver in the cold up there.
Obviously,
not
a problem playing in the cold for Peyton Manning anymore.
Yeah, it's tough to play up there for the opposing team. So if it was right now, Denver and Seahawks Super Bowl, what would you like? That's in New York.
That's right. I would have to take Seattle with their running game that they have the advantage in.
Man, if Seattle won the Super Bowl, that would be gigantic.
That would be. And I think they've got great DBs, too, which is very helpful when you're playing Peyton Manning. So I would have to take Seattle.
I could see that. And I could see Peyton losing in the thing as well.
And
it's
not really a homer call.
No,
I'm
not
really
a Seahawks fan.
Yeah,
no,
I'm not a Seahawks fan.
No.
So, if Seattle was from some other city, I'd still be picking them.
Sure. I actually like that pick.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's talk about NBA.
Yes.
Shall we?
So Kobe Bryant comes back.
Huge.
Yeah.
Mamba.
Yeah, nice. Comes back against Toronto.
Pretty amazing the fact that he came back this quick.
Yeah, I mean,
you think an injury is going to happen in the future for him?
Yeah, I think there will be something else this season that will shut him down.
Did you see the introduction he got in Toronto?
No.
Oh, it was like he was a home game.
Really?
I'm not kidding you.
Damn.
They went all out.
And they just signed him to like a two-year extension,
That was just ridiculous.
And that's just to try to get some other star to agree to come to L.A., knowing that Kobe will be there for at least a couple years. But
tell you what, though, Lakers is the 8th seed. I wouldn't want to face him.
Yeah.
If they were able to get in as the 8th seed, I would not want to face him.
You know, this Xavier Henry.
Yeah.
Xavier.
Yeah. Exactly.
He's a good player. They've got some good young guys there. I think
Wes Johnson.
Yeah.
I mean, that guy was a top three pick.
Yeah,
two
out
years
of
ago.
Syracuse, man. Yeah. They've got some good young talent. I think the dynamic's obviously going to change with Kobe being back. It's not going to be
take a while.
It's not going to be as wide open for the younger guys, but they've got some gunners down there. They've got Kamen in the middle. Gasol is still a force. Yeah, I wouldn't want to face him.
So let's talk about the West, since the East is absolute garbage besides those top two teams.
Yeah.
What about your Portland Trailblazers there, though?
Yeah, they're doing great. They lost the other night to Dallas, which was tough.
Monte Ellis, man.
Oh, that kid. I love that guy. I've loved him for a long time.
Long time player, man.
I want to have his baby. he had the dagger, the shot at the buzzer to beat the Blazers.
Yeah.
Blazers held strong.
Dirk up that
back foot.
That was so good. Man, yeah. How good is that guy's step back?
Yeah, that guy's going to go down. That signature shot's going to go down.
That's a Hall of Fame shot.
NBA history, yeah.
Yeah, they should just have the net with the net going right through the basket. Just like, absolutely pure.
Yeah, and, you know, the team's looking good. Good play out of Wes Matthews and Batum and Lillard.
Oklahoma City.
Lillard stepped it up the last few games. He's gotten 20, and then down in L.A., I think it was, he had, like, 32. So
yeah, Lillard's stud. Yeah. They beat Oklahoma City. Oklahoma City looks good, too.
They do.
But I think it's going to be the Spurs. I think the Spurs are going to be right back in line.
They're doing
the
same thing. They're flying under the radar right now.
Winning, beating anybody they want to beat. Whenever they want to beat them, basically, except for that one night in Portland that I saw.
Yeah. And, you got Golden State, who looks good.
Clippers aren't as good right now, I don't think. I think they've taken a step back. I can see Portland and the Clippers being almost even right now.
Yeah, I think the Clippers are a better team, but right now they're in a slump. They're not doing well. And then Sacramento just picked up Rudy Gay in
a trade from
Toronto.
Still, Sacramento's so terrible. I mean,
they're not
going to do a huge amount for him.
No, not really. And
but Rudy Gay is a hell of a player.
Yeah, he'll go good.
And he's a good guy. He's a real good character guy. That'll be good for DeMarcus Cousins and that whole little chaos scene down there.
Hopefully he'll be able to get things right.
And now we need to follow Chuck Hayes in his career because I do love the 6'6" center that is alive in the NBA. And so now he is off to Toronto.
Yeah, that's right.
AKA no man's land.
Yeah, you're
up there with DeMar DeRozan. Is probably the only player I know on Toronto's team.
What about Terrence Ross from Jefferson,
man?
Ross
on there.
He's not getting much playing time, unfortunately, this year, but that guy's a stud, man.
Anything else would have come? Oh, let's do Ducks basketball real quick. Ducks played huge game, and then we got a game against Illinois, and I'm going to be going to that one. But that game against Mississippi State, that's one for the ages. You got to go back and rewatch that game.
Yep.
That Marshall Henderson, the white kid.
Really?
Oh, man, he can light it up. He had like 38. The kid was just dropping these bombs from like half court, it felt like.
Damn.
But they're a stacked team. They feel great right now. You know, they got all these guys you don't know of because they come in every year, brand new guys. But it's going to be a hell of a season. So, boom, boom, boom. Let's do this thing.
Yeah, the last thing really I have to talk about was the baseball. We got Robinson Cano.
Huge. Overpaid contract.
$240 million 10-year deal with the Mariners.
So, let me get this straight. In the old days, they would not pay $250 million for Alex Rodriguez at the time when he was juicing and he was the great, going into MVP years of his career.
Exactly.
Instead, they're going to pay $240 for a less productive second baseman.
Yeah, juicing.
Who's coming in at the tail end of his career. You're going to pay that guy for the next 10 years?
Yeah.
To be a second baseman?
For your second baseman. And these contracts, they never pay off. The player never produces.
No, and there's no power with Cano either up in Seattle.
Seattle's a bigger stadium than
New York. Bigger stadium, dead air, wet marine climate. Yeah. It's a wrap.
Yeah, so I don't see it. It's a fascinating deal because it's to Seattle and because of the huge money. I don't think it's going to make Seattle a World Series contender by any means.
No, I mean, you took a guy like Adrian Beltre, who was hitting like 50 home runs a year, basically, shredded out of his mind, juicing. You brought him up to Seattle, he couldn't even hit like 20.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what the hell's a second baseman going to do?
Yep. And then
Ellsbury.
Yeah, Ellsbury goes to New York.
Huge
same
deal.
With Carlos Beltran. And
Beltran, I don't know about anymore.
Yeah. I've never been high on him. He had the one fan.
He struck out with us.
He had the one good playoffs with the
like seven bombs.
Yeah, with the Astros, and then after that,
yeah, then went to the Mets. Sucked.
Sucked. Yeah.
Now he's at the rest of your, actually did pretty well with Cardinals.
Yeah, he did actually. And then this happened a few weeks ago, maybe even a month ago, but we didn't mention it. Prince Fielder let off to the Rangers.
Prince is a little unproductive lately.
Yeah.
I mean, he signed a gigantic deal, just like Cano with the Tigers.
Yeah.
His deal was gigantor. And he came up and hit like 20 bombs a year up for Tigers. Man, you can't be doing that if you're Prince Fielder.
Yeah. And
he's got to be way more productive.
Yeah, and it's tough because he's
And he's getting all the pitches.
Yeah, exactly, because he's He's their
one of the greatest hitters of all time.
Exactly.
Hitting out of his mind in his lineup right next to him.
Exactly, because he's got Cabrera right there.
Dude, the shadow of Cabrera. I mean, you're dong on a Triple Crown shadow. You can't hit?
Yeah.
Come on, buddy.
Right, because they're definitely giving you pitches to hit with Cabrera. Yeah. But
he's gigantic, and it's going to end well for him. Or it's going to end poorly for him.
And then the last thing was Roy Halladay announces his retirement
as
a pitcher.
Hurt for a couple, 3 years lately.
Yeah.
But, he was a hell of a pitcher for a while, though. For about 4 years, he was probably the best pitcher in the game.
Yeah. Yep.
He had wicked stuff.
That's about it from the studio.
There you go, man. I'll give you some basketball footage. I'll go to the Rose Garden, get the video, and do all that stuff. And, yeah, we'll do it, man. Come back. We'll talk again before Christmas. We got some time.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Sports Chat 503.
All right. Be good, kids.
Adios.